హలో స్టూడెంట్స్, వెల్కమ్ టు ఈపీజీ పాఠశాల ఇన్ ఫుడ్ అండ్ న్యూట్రిషన్. టుడే యు ఆర్ గోయింగ్ టు లిజన్ టు ఎ న్యూ కైండ్ ఆఫ్ టాపిక్ విచ్ యూ మే నాట్ హ్యావ్ హెర్డ్ ఆఫ్. యూ మస్ట్ హ్యావ్ బీన్ యూస్ టు పీపుల్ టాకింగ్ టు యూ అబౌట్ డూయింగ్ రీసెర్చ్ అట్ ది యూజీ లెవెల్ యాజ్ వెల్ యాజ్ పీజీ లెవెల్. బట్ డ్యూరింగ్ ద రీసెర్చ్, యాజ్ యూ ఆల్ నో, వీ హ్యావ్ టూ కైండ్స్ ఆఫ్ రీసెర్చ్, రీసెర్చ్ యూజింగ్ అనిమల్స్ అండ్ రీసెర్చ్ యూజింగ్ హ్యూమన్ బీయింగ్స్. సో టుడే గోయింగ్ టు లిజన్ అబౌట్ why we use animals in research, and if we are going to use animals, then what are the ethical issues involved and how should we take care of the animals. I am Dr. Vasanta Muthuswamy. I am a doctor by profession. I was working as a senior deputy director general at the Indian Council of Medical Research, and during my term in the ICMR for 30 years I have been in charge of both ethics of animal experimentation and human experimentation. So this is what it is when you are asked to do research. If you do basic research, which is called the preclinical research, we use animals for experiments. Once you complete the animal experiment, we move on to the human beings, and whenever we use human beings, we call it clinical research. And so these are the two components of biomedical experimentation. Why do we use animals for research is something which is very important. When we look at the how it has evolved, there are various reasons why we use animals. The purpose of use of animals in biological sciences is something important. The first is, we of course use fundamental research, whether it's biological or biomedical science. If you want to develop a new treatment for diseases, you have to use animals first, try whether it is safe, whether it is efficacious, and then you do it in the human beings. If there are many products which are being developed, maybe chemicals, maybe drugs, maybe food products, can be anything. Any product has to go through safety testing in animals first before we move on to the human beings. There are new diagnostics which are being developed. There are new animal products which are being developed. And all these have gone through the animal testing first. And of course, in biology and medical education, animals were used in a great extent many years back when we were all students. But now, it's restricted to a great extent. Now, the importance of animals in biomedical research is known to many of you. If you have seen throughout the history, scientists have been solving many problems, developing new techniques, new treatment, as I said, all by using animals in biomedical research. So we as human beings, we should be very grateful for the animals which have sacrificed their lives for the purpose of improvement in the health of the human beings. It's a very interesting statement made by the former US Surgeon General, who said that virtually every major medical advance for both humans and animals has been achieved through biomedical research using animal models and throughout which are proof of the safety and efficacy of the new treatment. It's a very interesting statement made by the former US Surgeon General, who said that virtually every major medical advance for both humans and animals has been achieved through biomedical research using animal models and throughout which are proof of the safety and efficacy of the new treatment. Because of this, for both humans and animals, it's not just for the human's welfare we use it, even for the animal welfare, animals have been contributing. Life-saving surgical procedures, cancer treatment, organ transplantation, development of vaccines, very safe consumer products of all kinds, and treatment for countless other medical disorders and diseases have happened because we have used animals. Why we are using animals? What is the necessary? There are animal activists or animal welfare is always say, ultimately human beings are going to use it. Why we do use animals? You should not use animals at all. And so that's a constant fight between the animal welfareists and the biomedical researchers. The organs and the body systems of animals are similar to human beings as well as other animals. They are susceptible to the same diseases which affect the humans. The animal's lifespan is much shorter than human beings. You can't study throughout the life of a human being to see something is working for 50, 60 years. The lifespan and animals are very short, so within the lifespan you can study throughout their lifetime period. It's easy to put animals in an environment, keeping the variables in conditions to a minimum variable so that it's easy. If you are looking at the animals which are used in research, it's very interesting. All of you have heard animal welfare is fighting for the right of the animals, that so many animals are being harmed in the scientific and medical research and animals should not be used. But you look at the actual animals which are being used in research, the laboratory mice are used maximum, more often than any other animal species. These mice plus the other small rodents such as rats, hamsters, they make up for 90% of the total number of animals used. So it's only the rest 10% of the research or testing where other animal species are used, like dogs, cats, rabbits, farm animals, fishes, frogs, birds, and the non-human primate, that's the monkeys. And there are other animals also which are being used. And so this is necessary only for 10% of the research. So if you just look at the extent of the use of animals, 40% of the animals which are being used are for biomedical research purposes, for coming out with the new diagnostics and treatment. Drug testing and safety product testing, which is another 26% and 20%, that's about 46%. Teaching, the number has come down to just 6 to 7% now. And there are small other kind of research where for space research, testing for even arms and ammunitions, and this constitute another 7%. So you can see that the majority of the animals which are used is for the biomedical research and testing purposes, which constitutes almost again another 80 to 90%. Many people say that if you just think of what has happened so far, that will make you feel that yes, we are still in a time where animals are needed. Most of the nation's 1 million insulin dependent diabetes would have died if insulin was not discovered and used. More than 60 million would risk death from heart attack, stroke, kidney failure, or high blood pressure. Chemotherapy wouldn't have existed if you have not done all this. And there are many children who are now surviving blood cancers for many years because of this treatment. People disabled by stroke or spinal cord injury are then given rehabilitation so that they start moving around. More than 1 million would be blind if we had not found the treatment for cataract. Newborns who develop jaundice each year would contract, become cerebral palsy. Now they are preventable through phototherapy, which is also tried through animal experimentation first. So surgery of any type, and there are diseases which have disappeared from the earth like smallpox. All this could not have happened if you have not done the preclinical testing before coming to human beings. Similarly, even amongst the animals, there are millions of dogs, cats, and other animals. They would die from the animal-specific diseases like anthrax, distemper, and animal blood cancers are there. Cat develop feline leukemia, rabies, which is in dogs. For all these things also, treatments have been developed. And of course, polio, which has crippled so many children in the around the world. Now, India, we have declared polio free. And many countries have developed polio free, and we don't see anymore those children who cannot walk or who are disadvantaged physically because of this virus infection. But then, of course, there are major concerns because why the animal welfare is are always at a fight with us. There are definitely some concerns which we cannot say is cannot be thought about it. After all, the animals which are being tested undergo some pain and suffering. Is it necessary to put those animals through pain and suffering? Can this be avoidable? Can we do research but still see that the animals don't get pain? There are many animal interests are there. Are we doing any degree of infringement on the animal interests? If you look at the animals and they look at the phylogenetic scale in which all the living beings are placed, the lowest level in the are painless. As you come up, for example, like amoeba, bacteria, viruses, they don't feel pain. But as you come up in the phylogenetic scale, slowly, then when you send fishes and frogs, and then you come to cats and dogs, monkeys, and then human beings. And that's called the phylogenetic scale. As they come up, then the pain is sensation is much more. So you should try to use those animals which are lower in the phylogenetic scale so that they don't feel the pain. And wherever pain can be felt, you have to use analgesics and anesthetics so that they don't feel the pain. There are many endangered species in the world where animals are slowly disappearing from the earth. Now you have to be very careful, and those who are declared as endangered species cannot be used for experiments. There are many people who undertake experiments just for the sake of doing it. These are called purposeless experiments. Unless there is a purpose, there is a dire need to do these experiments, you should not use the animals. It is also important that those who are doing the experiment should have the competence, the training to handle the animals. Animals cannot be handled as if you are handling stones or papers. They are living beings. They have to be handled with care, and that training should be given. So those without training and not have the competence should not undertake animal experiments. Then above all, what is important is you must have good animal care facilities where these animals are kept. They should be given good nutrition, they should be taken care very well. If that is to be done, and then only you can use the animal. So these are the major concerns because of which the animal welfare is a fighting. If you look at the laws on animal experiments around the world, UK was the first country to enact the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act in 1876. At that time itself, they said that animal experiment can be sanctioned if there is a prescribed limit on pain to the animals. If you can use anesthetics, analgesics, because of which the pain will be felt less by them. And wherever the experiments are done, they have to be registered, they have to be designated, and all records should be maintained. You can imagine that it was in 1876 they passed this act, and they are following it very sincerely till date. Of course, India is one of the earliest countries to come out with a similar act, and we have the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act enacted in 1960, which was again updated and modified in 1982. There is one more revision is undergoing now. Very soon we will have the next amendment to the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. Even France enacted it only in 63 and USA enacted it in 66. Now, all this, at that time itself it was said that it's necessary that there has to be somebody who will check that all these requirements are taken care of, that before doing an experiment, all these concerns are taken care of, and so that you put in position certain procedures to avoid pain and suffering to the animals. So it became necessary that each institution doing animal research or using animals for experiment should have an institutional animal care and use committee. In USA, it became mandatory in 1985, and it was mandated by their Animal Welfare Act under the public health laws. And there was an international organization was set up which will take care of the care of the animals and see that this is being done properly, and they have done supervision. And they also said that this is a committee which will approve any protocol where animals to be used. Unless they are satisfied, nobody can do research. It's very interesting that in 1956, two scientists from UK, they came out with a book called The Principles of Humane Experimental Techniques on Animals. And these two scientists are Russell and Birch, and they said, if you want to do your animal experimentation with responsibility, so that is for responsible use of animals in research, you have to remember three R's. The first R is reduction, that is reduction in the number of animals. So try to use only minimum numbers which is statistically significant. Don't, unless just because animals are available, simply don't use hundreds of animals. Second is reduction in species. As I said, in the phylogenetic scale, you see which is the lowest at the level of animal which will be useful for your experiment. So you can't do experiment on monkey and frog together. So you have to go step by step, do in rats and mice first, and then if you find it useful, then only you can come to cats, dogs and monkeys. So let a reduction in species. The second R is the R refinement. Whatever is your procedures, you should be refined. You should use very good equipments, knives, needles, which will produce minimum pain to the animals as possible. So you should have refinement of techniques. And of course, the next R is the R for replacement. If you can find an alternative methods instead of using animal, that's the best. Although it is not yet reached at this stage now that we can use alternates for animal experiment, there are many tests where now you have alternate methods by using cell cultures, tissue cultures, cell lines, where the testing is done instead of the animals. And wherever it's necessary only, animals are used. So although the replacement has started, but I think it will take some more years for us to totally replace animal experiments. So R for replacement. In addition to that, many people say that reuse is another R, where if animals are already in the animal house, they have been used, they are healthy, you can reuse them instead of making new animals go through these procedures. And the next R, which is there only in India, is the R for rehabilitation. If you use animals, large animals, then you have to, it's the responsibility of the researchers to see that after your experiments are over, these animals are rehabilitated for the rest of their life. In India, we have the National Center for Laboratory Animal Sciences, which is called NICLAS. This is situated at the National Institute of Nutrition at Hyderabad, which is the institute in India where animals are bred, they are taken care of, they are supplied to the whole country for doing research, and now we have few more institutions which have come up. Most recently, original plan to have a national animal resource facility for biomedical research at Genome Valley, Hyderabad is now recently become the 34th ICMR Institute. This is also in Hyderabad, where from small animals to large animals, all animals will be bred, kept carefully, they will be well maintained, and they will be supplied to the researchers and the industry together, whoever wants to use these animals. So that you have good quality animals, well taken care of, which can be used for your experiments, so that your experiment results are good. If you look at all the guidelines in India, we have the Prevention of Cruelty to Animal Act, as I said, amended in 82. The Central Drug Research Institute in Lucknow came out with a laboratory animal ethics and technology document in 91. The Indian National Science Academy, they took responsibility themselves to come out with the guidelines on care and use of animals for scientific research in 92, which was revised in 2000. But the most important rule which we have now, which is very mandatory, which everybody has to follow, came only in 98, which is the breeding and experiments on animals, the control and supervision rules 98, which was amended in 2001 and 2006, brought out by CPCSEA. So in India, animal experiment means everybody has to know what is CPCEA, what is the guideline which they have brought out in 2002 and updated in 2003. And which is the committee for the purpose of control and supervision of experimentation on animals, which is under the PCA Act. This is a guideline on the organization which is responsible for taking care of animal experiments in this country, and you are bound by the guideline they have issued, the rules, notifications they are giving, and the whatever is orders which they are passing. The Indian Council of Medical Research brought out a guidance document in 2006 which has got all the guidelines which are there in the nationally, internationally, the rules and the amendments, everything put together in one document for so that it becomes easy for scientists to use it. More recently, in 2010, the Committee for the Control of Experimentation also came out with a standard operating procedure for the institutional animal ethics committees, and that has to be followed, all the animal ethics committees. Yes. So these are the guidelines which are there. We have the INSA guideline, there is a guideline for the use of small animals in medical colleges and institutions, and we have the CPCA guidelines for the animal facility, which is the mandated guideline for this country. There are many international documents which are brought out by various international agencies. So whenever you want to know that what are international standards, you have to go through these guidelines, which are from the WHO, COM, the US and the other agencies have brought out these guidelines. What one has to know when you are handling animals is the salient features of this 1998 breeding and experimentation rules notified by the CPCA. According to this, from 98 onwards, all establishments which are using animals for research as well as breeding animals have to be registered. Without the registration and registration number, you can't touch animals. You have to have an institutional animal ethics committee. Unless the animal gives clearance for experiments with animals, smaller animals, you can't do experiment. For large animals, after the Institutional Animal Ethics Committee clears, it has to go to a subcommittee of CPCA in Delhi, which is called the Large Animal Subcommittee, which has recently been scraped. So for all large animals, the protocols after the approval from the institutional committees will go to the Central Committee in New Delhi. They develop formats for keeping all records and submissions, and also at that point of time, there were restrictions were put on importing animals from other countries and also doing contract testing. So this was in 98, and then following this, there were a lot of objections raised by the scientific community on restriction of animal imports and contract testing. So the modifications were done in 2001 and 2006. So the 2001 and 2006 amendments were made to these rules, where the definition of experiment was clarified that all experiments which have significant gains in the well-being of people of the country or will be considered as experiments. So testing of vaccines, testing of products will also come under experiment. The procurement of animals can be done in case the animals are not available in the registered breeders within this country, then you can look for alternate legal sources from here or from outside. The contract animal experiment, which was not allowed in the 98, was subsequently relaxed that if the establishments are registered and they do according to the PCA Act, follow all the regulations, they can do contract animal experiments also. So these were the amendments which were made, and then according to these rules, The Institutional Animal Ethics Committee composition was given. Who should be the members? There will be a representative of the department where it is located. Scientists with knowledge of animal handling and animal experiments should be members from other institutions. There has to be expert veterinarian who should be in the committee. We will see that whatever procedures you are following is right or wrong. And in addition to that, there should be member of the community who should be there to see that animals are well taken care of. For this purpose, the CPCA Central Committee in Delhi nominates a person from a local neighboring institutions or from any other state who will be member of this committee, who will be representing the CPCA, but at the same time they are knowledgeable about the concerns of the community as well as the concerns of the other scientists. And there has to be the person who is in charge of the animal facility. Every institution should be the member. The Institutional Ethics Committee will review and approve research projects. They will prevent unnecessary suffering to animals, which is there or not. They will check, they will look at the what is the kind of accommodation and veterinary care which you are taking. Whether you, after the animals, experiment the animals, if they are dead or injured, are you doing humane disposal after the termination? What are the procedures being followed? If necessary, they can even say that stop the study in between because no point in continuing experiments further. And they will also see that whether the person who is proposing to do the research is adequately skilled and experienced or not. So the INSA itself had given the guidelines how should be a good animal facility. So it had given all details about how the animals should be kept, what kind of a drug should be used for anesthesia. When the animals die, how do you do the euthanasia? How do you take care of the injured? And then what is the constitution of the ethics committees? All these were given by the INSA guideline itself. And when you look at the CPCA guidelines, which came much later, the CPCA guidelines will have much more details. According to the international standards, these facilities have been given, and one has to go by these guidelines and see that everything is put into control for your animal house to get the registration from the CPCA. Only then you will be allowed to keep it. Much later, there are new developments have come. They have come out with the operational guidelines. So what should be done? They have scrapped the large animal committee. The main committee sees the applications now. The committee has been reconstituted. Rehabilitation guidelines have been issued for larger animals, and the standard operating procedures have been developed for the ALT. So we have to increase awareness among the scientists for rational use of animals. What animals to be used? What number should be used? We have to popularize the components of all the 3 R's and the additional R's. All establishments have to be registered. Adequate training should be given for animal handlers. We have to set up appropriate institutional animal ethics committees. And most important is to maintain a transparent system for humane use of animals. So there are various suggestions for this. You have to have a good functioning institutional animal ethics committees. You have to increase research on alternatives so that a day will come animals need not be used. And we have to develop a mechanism for checking the human treatment of animals. The editorial responsibility is taken up by the editors that unless you go through all these procedures, your paper will not be published. Unless we have ethical discussion in the mainstream literature about what are the issues related to the animal experiment, people will not even be aware that there are issues to be taken care of. And teaching of ethics of animal experiment should be started from the undergraduate level to PG level so that the students are aware of all these issues even before come to a stage of doing it. Training courses have to be increased because the whole country, there are hundreds of institutions or thousands of institutions doing research. Everybody has to be well trained. Unless we give adequate funds for animal houses, you can't maintain a good animal house. Detailed guidelines have to be issued, and the breeding program should be there so that you get quality genetically defined animals. And then, of course, we have to keep on training for upholding the R's of our animal experimentation. This is the document which has their ICMR document released in 2006, which gives you all the details. To conclude, you can understand from whatever you heard so far, use of animals in research is inevitable at the current level of knowledge. It's in the interest of both animals and human welfare. There are mandatory statutory requirements for developing new drugs and testing which have to be followed. We have to use animals at this stage until the total alternatives will come in the coming near future. The national and the international laws and guidelines are there which have to be followed. We have to develop specific animal models for rational animal use so that you don't have to right and left use all kinds of animals. Efforts should be there to develop the alternates on priority basis. And as I said, most important is teaching of animal ethics at every level of education. Also, we have to have a public awareness in conjunction with the NGOs or the animal welfare is that how the animals should be taken care of. If you can do all these things, the we can say that the animals who use for experiment will thank us, because a good animal care and good science will go hand in hand. Thank you all for the listening.